Hello everybody, Hooded Cobra Commander 788 here, and I'm back with another vintage G.I. Joe toy review, and this time I'm doing a requested review. Somebody requested this particular figure a long time ago, and that person might have thought that I forgot, but I didn't forget. I was one accessory away from completing the figure, and now it's done, and now it's ready, and now we're gonna look at the 1987 G.I. Joe Undercover Chuckles. It seems like his specialty should say something more than just undercover. Really, he's a covert operations agent who specializes in undercover work. So let's go ahead and look at the toy.
This is Chuckles, the G.I. Joe undercover. Undercover agent, I guess. He was first sold in 1987. He was also available in 1988. And when he came out in 1987, he was sort of a replacement for Lady J, who was the covert operations specialist, sort of an undercover agent. Chuckles was discontinued in 1988, and he wasn't really replaced by anyone who took over that role. Let's take a look at Chuckles' accessories, starting with his pistol. The contents list of the card on which Chuckles was packaged calls this a Colt Combat Commander 45, which I don't think it really looks like that. It has a different profile from that real world weapon. It has this sort of elongated barrel, which the Colt Commander did not have. The ejection port is in the wrong places, a bit farther forward, although the ejection port on the Colt Commander was not directly above the grip, but this is too far forward to be that Colt weapon. However, it does have this sort of loop-style hammer that the Colt Commander did have, so it does have that similarity. The pistol that came with the 1986 version 2 of Hawk is closer to the real-world Colt Commander than this pistol is, but still not an exact match. Chuckles' only other accessory is this brown holster. It's made out of soft plastic, and it has a belt buckle in the back. You can remove it. There are two positions you can have this holster in. You can either have it over his shoulder like that, or if you undo it in the back here, and you see that it has two notches on the belt, you can put it around his waist, cowboy style. Just tighten the belt to the second notch, and there you go. Now he's got his holster on his hip. It's hollow on the backside, as you can see, and this is really great. I love this accessory. From 1982 to 1987, this is the first working holster that we had. And the fact that they were able to do this for a figure like Chuckles means they could have done this on other figures that really could have used working holsters, like the 1986 Hawk, which had this big, bulky, plastic sculpted-on holster on his leg. That could have been an actual holster to hold this easily lost pistol. They could have done it. They could have done it. They should have done it. I would have liked to have had a lot more real working holsters. Although I am a vintage guy and I prefer the vintage G.I. Joe action figures, one thing that I really like about the modern era figures is they do tend to have working holsters like that. I like that a lot. Let's look at the articulation on Chuckles. He had the standard articulation of 1987 G.I. Joe action figures. That means he could turn his head from left to right like that. He could also look up and down. His head was on a ball joint. He could move his arm up at the shoulder about so far. He could swivel it all the way around. He had a hinge at the elbow. He could move at the elbow about 90 degrees. He had a swivel at the bicep. He could swivel his arm all the way around. The figure was held together with a rubber O-ring that looped around the inside. He could move at the torso a little bit. He could move his legs apart about so far. He could move his leg at the hip about 90 degrees, and he could bend at the knee about 90 degrees. Let's take a look at the sculpt, design, and color of Chuckles, and it's been said that Chuckles is supposed to be based on Don Johnson of Miami Vice fame. So, taking a look at his head sculpt, looking at his head sculpt, does he look like Don Johnson? I have to be honest and say no, he doesn't really. He looks a bit older, and there's some puffiness around his eyes. That really doesn't look much like Don Johnson at all. However, the artwork on his card, I think, does look more like Don Johnson. The head sculpt just doesn't quite match it. The artwork on the card looks enough like Don Johnson that you're definitely supposed to think of him, but it doesn't look so much like the real actor that representatives of Don Johnson would send cease and desist letters to Hasbro. He has blonde wavy hair, brown eyebrows and eyes, and that's about it. It's a fairly simple head sculpt. His chest, as you can see, has this Hawaiian shirt on it in light blue with pink flowers and green little palm leaves. And I'm going to talk more about this very loud colored shirt and this entire outfit, in fact, a little bit later, so I won't comment too much on it now. This is made of light blue plastic, and this light blue plastic can experience some yellowing over time, which will cause it to turn a greenish color, so you do need to watch out for that. The arms feature short sleeves and this same Hawaiian shirt pattern, as you can see, and he has bare forearms, no watch or anything like that. It would have been nice if he had a watch sculpted on here, but if they had put a watch on his wrist, they might have thought they'd have to paint it, they'd have to apply another paint app to it, and of course those paint applications can be expensive, so to keep the cost of the toy down, they probably just skipped that. A watch would have been nice though, but it's better to not have the detail than to have an unpainted detail. So if they had to make a choice between having an unpainted watch and having no watch at all, I think they made the right choice. We have had other G.I. Joe figures with bare forearms like this, so I thought maybe these lower arms were reused parts from other figures. I thought maybe Gung-Ho's right arm, but that is not a match. That is not reusing Gung-Ho's right arm. And of course the other figures that came out in 1983 with the swivel arm battle grip, like Breaker here, had bare forearms, but again, they don't match. So these are actually unique sculpts. These are brand new forearms on Chuckles. They don't appear to be reused parts, even though they easily could have reused parts from other action figures. Oddly, it isn't the Hawaiian shirt where this figure starts to get weird. It's the lower half of the figure, where on the waist piece, as you can see, he has a military-style belt with pouches that continues around to the back. He has olive drab green pants. On his right leg, he has a knife or a machete or something like that. Nothing on the other side, just some sculpting on the trousers. And he has black army-style boots. There's a lot to say about the overall look of this figure, but I want to save that for later in the video, because I want to go ahead and look at the file card. This file card was printed on the back of the card on which the action figure was packaged. You can see some of the artwork on the front of the card there. It has his faction as G.I. Joe, and it has a portrait of Chuckles. Again, this does look a bit more like Don Johnson. I definitely think that was the inspiration for this character. His code name is Chuckles, and he is the Undercover. I really think this should say Undercover Agent, but it just says Undercover. It has his file name as Philip M. Provost. His primary military specialty is Criminal Investigations Division. Criminal Investigations Division of what? It doesn't say. Secondary military specialty, intelligence, and I really think that is his main role. That should be his primary military specialty. His birthplace is Little Rock, Arkansas. He has a grade of E5. It says he's from Little Rock, Arkansas, but it does not list his Arkansan accent as a speech impediment, which it should. This top section says, Chuckles has been undercover for so long that nobody is really sure about who he actually works for. Well, since he's on the G.I. Joe team, he'd better be working for G.I. Joe, otherwise we have a big problem. He got his start in hole and corner operations at Southeastern Insurance Group in Fort Lauderdale, where he still feels he owes his main allegiance. Okay, two things here. Hole and corner essentially just means secret operations. And he feels he owes his main allegiance to Southeastern Insurance Group. Why? That's really weird. What the hell kind of insurance company is that? Chuckles is a man's man, every CID boy's favorite companion. Oh great, another dude bro. Or maybe it means he's a man's man in that he likes men, and that's why he's every CID boy's favorite companion. Well, you know what? If so, there's nothing wrong with that, and I won't ask, and he doesn't have to tell. Not just because of his jocularity or his perseverance in the field, but because he is so conscientious about keeping up his cover that he'll volunteer for missions that nobody else wants to go on. This bottom section has a quote. It says, Chuckles' natural likability is his greatest asset. He can sit around all day with a bunch of cobras, grinning, cracking jokes and punching shoulders, all the while wearing a miniature transmitter that's been homed in on by the Joe team. Chuckles is aware of the consequences of being found out. He's also confident of his ability to fight his way out of any situation. The fact that he's a likable and funny guy is probably why he's called Chuckles, and this file card depicts him as being really super duper good at undercover. And he's not just good at undercover, but he's a tough guy. He can fight his way out of any situation, so he's not afraid to resort to fisticuffs. Taking a look at this figure overall, is he really dressed for undercover work? There might be some parts of the world where this outfit would not be conspicuous. Maybe some tropical jungle village marketplace. Even the army trousers and the machete might not be out of place there. But most of the world, this is going to be a very conspicuous outfit. Or you might say, without the shoulder holster and just with the Hawaiian shirt, he's trying to blend in without looking like he's trying to blend in. So while Cobra is looking for spies wearing trench coats and dark glasses, they will completely miss the guy in the Hawaiian shirt. The combination of the Hawaiian shirt and the army trousers is harder to explain. Of course, as an undercover agent, he would wear whatever is appropriate for whatever mission he's on, but Hasbro gave us an outfit that's appropriate undercover almost nowhere. It almost looks like he has the bottom half of a different action figure. In Miami Vice, Don Johnson didn't really wear Hawaiian shirts like that. That's a little bit more indicative of Tom Selleck from Magnum PI. But of course, Chuckles didn't look like Tom Selleck. But you know who kind of did? Cutter. In fact, if you replace this Boston Red Sox cap with a Detroit Tigers cap, change the hair color, you'd have a dead ringer for Tom Selleck. Don Johnson was connected to G.I. Joe. In fact, he was a voice in the 1987 G.I. Joe animated movie, and that animated movie included Chuckles. But Don Johnson did not do the voice of Chuckles, he did the voice of Lieutenant Falcon. And in fact, Chuckles had no lines in that movie, so no one did the voice of Chuckles.
Let's talk about the Don Johnson connection. Many people assume that this character is based on Don Johnson as he appeared in the TV series Miami Vice. Now, Miami Vice was a TV series that ran from 1984 all the way to 1989. So 1987 would have been the height of its popularity, when just dressing like Don Johnson automatically made you cool. I'm not wearing any socks!
Chuckles' first portrayal in the G.I. Joe comic book was in an issue that I didn't really care for. It was, I thought, a weak issue. The story wasn't interesting to me. It was drawn by Todd McFarlane before he kind of became famous as an artist on Spider-Man. But I don't think Todd McFarlane's art style fits G.I. Joe at all. And I did not like that issue at the time, and I still don't really like that issue of the G.I. Joe comic book. In both the G.I. Joe comic book and his appearance in the G.I. Joe animated movie, Chuckles is portrayed as a really big, beefy guy. And I was gonna say that that doesn't really fit his role as an undercover agent, but his file card does say he's a man's man and he can fight his way out of any situation, so maybe that is appropriate for Chuckles, but the sculpt on the action figure doesn't show him any larger or any more muscular than any other average G.I. Joe action figure. As a kid, I didn't really like Chuckles, and in fact, I don't think I ever got the action figure. In 1987, I was starting to get a little bit fed up with the way G.I. Joe was moving away from military elements and was throwing in things like Hawaiian shirts on these guys. So as a kid, it really wasn't my favorite. As an adult, I actually appreciate it more. His character can add a little bit of cloak and dagger to G.I. Joe, which I could appreciate, and maybe if I were a little bit more open-minded as a kid, I might have appreciated this figure more then. As an adult collector assessing this figure, I have to put it about in the middle of the pack. It's not a bad action figure, but it's not great, and I never had a connection to the character as a kid, so I don't really have any nostalgia for Chuckles. So yeah, about middle of the road, that's where I would put this figure. That was my review of Chuckles. I hope you liked it. If you did, don't forget to give it a thumbs up on YouTube, and don't forget to subscribe. I've got a lot of great new G.I. Joe toy reviews coming up. You don't want to miss them. And don't forget to like the Facebook page. You get a lot of updates there you don't get anywhere else. I'll be back next week for another vintage G.I. Joe toy review. I'll see you then.
Stevie Wonder. Nah, that's dumb.